And next, we will hear from Dr. Cynthia Bennett, Senior Research Scientist in Responsible AI and Human-Centered Technology at Google. And she will speak to her experiences with descriptive text during peer review.
Thank you. Can you hear me?
Yes, I hear you well.
Great, thank you. So I'll give a brief visual description. I am a blind white woman with my dark brown hair worn down, and I'm wearing a black shirt. And I'm a human-computer interaction researcher, but I'm not here to talk about that today. I am here to talk to you as a blind peer reviewer. No, I am not talking about the process where authors don't know their reviewers and reviewers don't know their authors. I am actually blind and I actually peer review scientific papers. Unlike language choices we can make now, such as switching that phrase to anonymous review, changing our culture to normalize accessible papers will take a lot more effort and iteration. We're going to talk a lot about that today, but as I was requested to speak from my personal experiences, I will now take you on a journey through part of my academic service, peer reviewing. I'm doing this to make one point. People encounter scientific papers in different roles with different goals, and they have different needs. So first, I'll go over a technology I use to engage with scientific papers. I use screen readers, which are software that communicate information and allow for keyboard and non-visual interactions, such as reading, writing, and filling out web forms. I either receive information through a speech synthesizer or by reading it in Braille from output onto a hardware display. Information and applications are not screen reader accessible by default, but must be intentionally designed so. And while automation can help remediate some access, it does not replace accessible design. For example, optical character recognition, called OCR, is pretty good at extracting text. It's been in development for decades, but it's still an interpretation, not the original, and I regularly encounter misinterpreted words. And AI-generated image descriptions, which might help me access non-text information like charts and graphs, are rudimentary and not yet sophisticated enough for scientific paper figures. Now I'll truly start reviewing my review process. So to become eligible to review papers, I had to get experience reading and writing them. And reading papers is honestly one of the most difficult aspects of my work. I'm not talking about comprehending them, spending time to mull over the research questions, think about the methods they chose or the results they got and what that means for our future. I am talking about literally reading them. First, I open the paper to learn if by some miracle it's accessible. And when it isn't, which often it's not, I run the paper through an OCR tool. Then I read the text and decide if I want to ask someone to describe the figures. I usually don't. It's often taken so much time for me just to open the paper and read the text that it's not worth it. And so my research is text heavy though, and I get to make this choice, and my peers who rely on non-text data might not be able to make this choice. I heard that sighted people often engage with papers in the opposite way by glancing through the paper figures first. That sounds nice and is not usually an option for me. When I write papers, I have to plan ahead how to make them accessible. Ironically, I cannot make my own papers screen reader accessible. Often the formatting requirements and file type conventions of the venues where I publish require processes that I can't complete with a screen reader. And then the accessibility remediation process is also not accessible with a screen reader. So I plan ahead and I delegate this work. But finding people to help me was particularly difficult when I was a junior scholar. Junior scholars in my field are often the ones who do the administrative work of publishing. So when we make calls for accessible scientific papers, we need to recognize where this work usually falls and be strategic to prevent it from becoming invisible labor. I do, however, collaboratively write figure descriptions with my cited co-authors. I actually really enjoy this part because it enriches our understanding of the data. The process prompts us to ask critical questions about how to present the information clearly. This improves the paper beyond the figure descriptions, which initially motivated these conversations. Next, I'll talk about peer reviewing, which I've been doing for 9 years. when I peer review, I can't make paper reading cost benefit trade-offs. Like, I don't really need to understand the figures in this paper I'm going to cite in my lit review, do I? No, I need to understand the paper completely. I am making a decision about whether it should be published or not. Sometimes I ask a colleague to help me just by describing the paper's figures, and this actually violates reviewer codes of ethics to keep the work confidential. But I'm running a different cost-benefit calculation now. My review needs to show that I clearly understand the work. Sometimes I ask someone above me in the peer review hierarchy, for example, the external review coordinator for a conference or a journal editor. This keeps me from violating reviewer codes of ethics, but it requires me to explain, I'm blind and I need support. And oh yeah, this is what a screen reader is and this is what OCR is, but OCR doesn't analyze images. Can you please help me? Occasionally, the figures have detailed descriptions that not only let me know that a figure is present, but also include the key visual takeaways. And I get to procrastinate on my reviews just like sighted people. Just kidding, sort of. Then, after being a peer reviewer for some years, something new happens. Yes, you get a little more efficient at writing those reviews, but you also get more requests to do more things with greater responsibility. I'm starting to take on external reviewer coordination roles. This is common in my field of computer science, where we often publish at conferences. I will get a batch of 7 to 10 papers, and I need to recruit 2 to 3 external reviewers for each paper. I need to understand the paper. Then I need to interpret the reviews and synthesize them into a meta review. And then I need to be available in case any of the external reviewers need anything. I have a greater responsibility. One day, I might coordinate an entire paper proceedings or guest edit a journal special issue. In this role, I wouldn't read all of the papers in such detail, but I would be responsible in the most high-stakes situation, like if ethical concerns come up. And I would have to quickly get familiar with these papers, including their figures. I'm telling you more than you ever wanted to know about my academic service to make one point. People come to scientific papers in different roles with different goals, and they have different needs. But predominant image description best practices emphasize that the most brief description is best. And as few of them as I encounter, accessible scientific papers are often made accessible at publication time, not at submission time when the great review responsibility happens. While this is likely an unconscious perpetration on behalf of individuals, at a structural level, remediating accessibility and insufficient figure descriptions reinforces an ableist hierarchy of access and power to the sciences based on perceived abilities and disabilities. This sends messages that first, paper readers are fully sighted, and second, people that use access technologies like screen readers and Braille displays are casual readers who don't really need to understand everything, rather than influential decision makers. So I mentioned that I am a blind peer review. And in summary, my blind peer review is that currently we are approaching accessibility as if it is something to remediate after the science is done. But as the tagline of this event argues, as open science is accessible science. So I will be generous. I said I was a blind reviewer, not reviewer two. And I am only that sometimes. Instead of rejection, I know we can do better. And so let's work on our major revision toward making scientific papers born accessible. Thank you so much.